Good afternoon. Poli Magana with APOC TV down here at Italiano's restaurant in El Centro California. Rated number one for pasta, pizza, and salads, and they have certificates to prove it, 2015. Tonight, we're going to be interviewing Rudy Seanez, Major League Baseball player from Raleigh, California, born and raised. Played 20 years in the Major Leagues, so stay tuned. But I want to ask the basic question, you know, what really motivated you? What motivated you to start playing baseball in the beginning?
Growing up, I had older cousins, so in order to hang out with them, I had to be able to keep up. Mm-hmm. And if I wasn't good enough to be on the team, then I had to go back home. So I didn't want to go home. So you had to kind of get better. I didn't know, but you just kind of try and play with them, and that was my motivation, just to be able to hang out with those guys and be able to be a tag along, basically, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when did you decide you wanted to be a pitcher?
Probably when I was about 9 years old. I started out playing third base, but pitching just seemed more fun to me. And when I was 10, I was in what they call the majors, 10 to 12 year olds, and I only got to pitch batting practice. Which for me was good enough. And then my first game, real game, was when I was 11. And it was the last game of the season. I got to pitch the last inning, so that was pretty cool. And then next year I was a starter, so.
Wow, and that was it.
And that was it. That was it.
So did you dream about being a professional baseball player? Or was it something you just wanted to be a part of, and all of a sudden, at some point, it took off from there?
I did, but it seems so far away. Coming from Raleigh, and you're watching TV at the time, Fernando Mania was going on. Fernando Valenzuela was pitching for the Dodgers, everybody's going crazy. And as a kid, you only dream of it. You don't think it's really possible. But then you hear his story, where he was from, how he got there. And it still seemed far away. But, throughout the years, it just seems to creep a little bit closer and closer. But still, it's tough, man. And you just kind of hoped maybe one of these days you'll be blessed enough to play there.
Right. So it kind of becomes more attainable the closer you get to it, I think. What's what we believe.
Yeah, and the more work you put into it, I think the more you believe in yourself that you'll get there one day.
So what team did you want to be a part of? What was like your favorite dream team? Was it the Dodgers, or who was it?
Growing up, I played watching the Angels and the Dodgers, and my favorite team at the time was the California Angels, just because of Nolan Ryan. Mm-hmm. At the time, yes, he was the most powerful pitcher in baseball. He had the fastest fastball, clocked at over 100 miles an hour. So I remember watching one of the games when he was pitching, and I thought that was my goal, was to throw 100 miles an hour. And so from then on, I was hooked on watching the Angels and Nolan. And the Dodgers were there too, of course, because they had Bert Hooten, who was one of my pitching coaches, mm-hmm, at one point. And Don Sutton was on the team, Jerry Royce, who was also one of my pitching coaches, and met a lot of those guys that we watched.
Thank you.
Playing on TV. I met a lot of them later on in my career, which was pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's great. So the interesting thing is that you went straight from high school to the major leagues. Back in those days, it was kind of a common thing, maybe not so common, but today it's really not allowed. They want kids to go straight from high school to go to college. But back in those days, more frequently, as people would go from high school to the majors. So what was that step? I mean, you're talking about from high school being 18, 17 years old, and the next thing you know, you're playing on some big mound in front of 80,000 people. What was that like?
Well, actually, I went from high school to, rookie ball.
Rookie ball.
I went to rookie ball. I was in the minor leagues for 3 years, from 86 to 89, and then I got called up to the big leagues in September of 1989. And getting called into the office and your manager telling you that, hey, you made it, you're going up. You're leaving tomorrow. And that was pretty cool. You get butterflies and you're nervous as heck, because even though it's the thing you wanted your whole life, you still can't believe it's happening. And when it does happen, you're just, a million things are going through your mind. Am I good enough to make it? Am I gonna do well, and this and that, and who are they playing, and all this kind of stuff. And so it was awesome, but also nerve-wracking at the same time.
To me, since I was a little boy, I was always intrigued by just the look of a stadium. It's like the Coliseum. It's just beautiful, amazing, with all the colors, and just how could we build something so amazing? To me, it was amazing. But, I can only imagine what it would have been like to be standing on a mound, the center point of attention in front of 80,000 people. I mean, being a young boy from the small town of Raleigh, California, and here you are pitching your first Major League Baseball game. What were you thinking then?
You know, lots of things. You're nervous, you're excited, you're everything at the same time, and I think the only thing I was thinking was just making sure I reached the glove, you know. Just nervous, man. Yeah, you don't want to air it out, because in the bullpen, man, I was all over the place, you know. I was like, oh god, I'm not gonna be able to throw a strike. So you're just hoping you can just get it there and you know, get through the inning, and luckily everything turned out great. But man, talk nerves. Wow.
I bet. So what was it like pitching? Like, for example, because you have a lot of there had been people playing baseball for many years before you even got there. Mm-hmm. And some of these guys, probably you were fans of theirs.
Yeah.
So here you are, you're pitching to what would be a big name, I guess you could say, that would be kind of starstruck, maybe looking at them across the mound. Who would that be?
Dave Winfield, Ricky Henderson, Dave Parker. I mean, guys like that. And all of a sudden, they're at the plate, you know? And I remember one time when we were at Angel Stadium, and I was walking across the field, and Dave Winfield was walking across at the same time, and I swear, I was looking at his waist. He was so dang big, man. He was huge. And I thought, my God, this guy's huge. But you know, you could see throughout the game, and just watching all these guys, what made them great, you know? I actually faced him that day in Anaheim, and faced him and Parker. And it's crazy to see him at the plate, because they're so huge, and you know, bats look like toothpicks, and you're just like, man, what am I doing here? You know, but it was good. It was fun. It was pretty amazing. And at the same time, it's just like, wow, I'm over here competing with these guys, you know?
Yeah, it's just amazing. Huh?
Yeah.
I can imagine, only imagine. So did you build any rivalries with any baseball players, like big names? It doesn't matter who it is, but did you have any players that you really just hated to pitch against, someone that you just knew that was going to be a big battle?
Yeah, there was
eye contact. Yeah. Up,
you know? No, there was not really any of that, but it was just kind of knowing, man, this guy owns me, you know? I haven't gotten this guy out in 3 years. You know, Ellis Burks was one of them. He was a pretty great player for a number of years, a number of different teams, and he's one of the guys. I remember one time we were in Texas when I was with the Rangers, and he's up next, so they call me in to pitch against him, and I called you in. My manager told me I called you in because I know you've gotten this guy out a lot of times, and I didn't say anything in my. My catcher says, hey, what do you want to go after him with? I go, dude, I've never gotten this guy out in my life. And he goes, whatever you throw. I go, everything and the kitchen sink. And he goes, well, let's start him off with a changeup. And man, I'll tell you what, that was, I think that was the whole trick right there. It's throwing nothing but changeups to him, man. Because, yeah, that guy owned me. Yeah, and the other guy, I had good success against him, but the other guy I didn't like facing was Mark McGuire. He seemed like he knew every pitch I was throwing. And he was just missing it, you know? It was, yeah, that guy was scary.
So did he go yard on you?
No, he did not, but...
That says a lot there.
No, he didn't, but it was pretty scary facing a guy like that, because as a pitcher, sometimes you just think, you know, you just don't want anything coming back at you, especially off a bat like that.
Yeah.
You know, things probably going to come off the bat, probably 115, 120 miles an hour. It's not a lot of time to move from 60 feet away, so it's pretty scary with some of those guys. But it's fun, though. It's fun. It's, you know, adrenaline goes through the roof, and, you know, you're like this afterwards. You're just like, okay, calm down.
So he was. Would you say that he was probably the least one you like to pitch against? The least person?
There's a few. Him, yeah, McGuire, yeah. Again, you know, Ricky Henderson, I didn't like facing that guy just because if he did anything, I didn't want him. He is fast, and I didn't want him to do the little bat flip thing, you know? but he's a good dude. I like Ricky. I actually played with him in 2001 with the Padres. Mm-hmm. Great guy.
Yeah.
Great guy.
What was the most craziest ritual you ever seen?
It's just, I don't know, kind of just mild ones. Just how many steps a guy has to take to get from the clubhouse to the dugout steps, and certain times you got to get on the field, and what they eat. You know, the way they put, the order in which they put their uniform on,
yeah.
You know, or stuff they wear,
right.
Underneath certain shirts or hats, and just, yeah. So
baseball is more mental than football, I think, is, because it's more preparation mentally because it's like, you know, it's a lot of it's in a lot of ways. Because football, you go out there with your pads. Other sports, it's like more physical. But yeah. Baseball definitely has a lot more thinking because you got the chess game between the pitcher and the baseball player.
Yeah.
The batter and so forth.
Yeah, and yeah, you're always thinking with baseball and just preparing for the game in itself just will wear you out. You know, you have to have that time where you can just lock in, focus on what you need to do and what your plan of attack is going to be, either whether you're hitter or pitcher, you know, just things like that, what your manager wants to do. There's a lot of things that go on that people most don't know about just because they haven't experienced it. But if you try talking to them, they're just like, what? All those things you got to think about before you throw a ball, you know? So, but I kind of miss that. I kind of miss it because it was fun. Can drive you crazy at times, especially when you execute, and it still doesn't go your way. You know, let's just say execute perfect pitch for that situation, and the guy puts a bat on it and broken bat, and the ball just gets over the infield for a base hit, and you're just like, ah, you know, now what? Kind of thing. And but you know, that's baseball, man. That's what made it fun, but that's what also made it frustrating and maddening. That, you know what? It's like, I give up, I quit. You know, I'm no good.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you come back the next day and you got to forget about it.
Yeah.
And go back and get them.
Let's eat a little bit. This is good food here. Again, we're at Italiano's restaurant in El Centro, and we have calzones, pizza, salads, and that's awesome stuff. We're going to dig in a little bit and keep the interview going.
That takes a lot of preparation.
What was your philosophy? What did you do that was keeps you so consistent? Was it just staying out of the mess and all the hoopla of what people think the pros are supposed to be about? You just did your own thing and stay focused? How did you stay so focused?
My whole motivation playing that long, honestly, was to win a World Series ring. That was the whole thing. And I wanted to keep playing as long as I could and to finally get one of those rings. I've always seen guys that had them, and I always ask if I could, you know, look at them and stuff, and I always thought they were the best things ever. And I got a chance to see a lot of those, and you know, eventually, you know, as you, the longer you play, the more friends, you know, you make, and eventually some of those guys get to play in the World Series, and you know, you can't help but, you know, hope they do get one. And sometimes, you know, you got guys on both teams, and you're just like, well,
yeah,
you know, just kind of, all right, whoever wins one, either way, you know, I'm happy for them. And you know, we finally ended up getting one my last year, in 2008, yes, with Philadelphia. And the way that happened was I was with the Dodgers in spring training of 2008, and I ended up getting released a few days before the season started. And that's a real bad time to get released because, you know, everybody's rosters are set.
Not much time.
At the major league level and at the minor league level, so it's hard to, you know, to get anything. So I remember getting released, came home, really didn't know if anything was going to happen. My agent had just kind of waiting by the phone to see if anybody would call, and as luck would have it, Philadelphia called. And you know, I was like, okay. And I went in, told my wife, you know, yeah, we're going to Philly. And you know, at one point though, gotta admit, I was a little nervous about going there because Philly fans, great fans, tough fans, some of the toughest anywhere, very passionate. And I was thinking, man, I better be on the ball if I'm going over there.
Yeah.
As luck would have it, I had a great start. Had a great start with the team, and luckily I was in there. I think I was in their good graces, anyways, for the season, and everything turned out pretty well, man. And you know, we obviously had a great team. Top to bottom, great defense, pitching, everything. You know, we had what it took, and we ended up winning the whole thing, man. And it was awesome. It was awesome being on the field and everything. Yeah, it's just like, you know, we won. We were actually, first thing I thought, damn, I'm getting a ring. You know, and then after a while, reality sets in, and you're just like, man, that was a long season, and then your body's just tired.
Like 120 games, right? 125 games?
162 games, and the season's 182 days long, and you know, a lot of those days off are actually travel days.
Yeah.
I was in San Diego in 01. Yeah, it was 2001, and I was signing, and I set my glove on the railing by the bullpen, so I'm walking, you know, signing a couple things. The glove's probably 10 feet away from me, maybe. and I turned around real quick and I'm signing, just talking to a fan real quick. And I turned around and I was like, hey, did I drop my glove? Is my glove on the other side? I thought it fell, or you know, somebody may have gotten it. And mm-hmm. Hey, did you guys get my glove? No. And then one fan, he's like, some kid got it and he took off. I thought it was his. I would have said something. I thought it was his. He grabbed it and ran. I was like, that's my game glove.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, and the one I brought was brand spanking new, right out of a box that hadn't even been used.
Yeah.
I didn't even play catch with it. So I'm absolutely freaking. I'm like, I can't use this glove. So I asked another guy, I go, hey, what glove do you use? What glove do you use? It was similar to mine. It wasn't the exact same model, but it was similar. And it just felt weird, man. I was just like, all right, I'm just hoping no comebackers and I don't have to field anything because I'm probably not going to catch it or be able to grab it. Sure as shit, somebody hits a ground ball to first. I got to haul ass over there and cover first.
Uh-huh.
And as I put the glove up, I'm thinking, please catch it. Please catch it. Throw it hard enough for it to stick in the glove. And he fires one in there. And as soon as I felt it, I just squeeze it and with both hands.
Uh-huh. You got it.
Yeah, and I got it. I was like, God.
Thank God.
I'm like, man. I mean, we talk about being tested sometimes, you know?
Yeah. You know, and that's the thing. You know, I don't think a lot of people in the public even know what goes on in the baseball player.
Yeah, and it's just a small thing, but it's a big thing because if you don't get that out, I mean, that could start a rally. That can start all kinds of shit. And then if you lose, I mean, that could start a losing streak. You know, it can go from just a, you know, pebble to a freaking avalanche.
Yeah.
You know? And whether they want to believe it or not, everybody points to that game, that point in time, and it's your fault.
So you're done now, and what's it like being retired? I mean, how do you find time? What do you do in your time?
All my time is I'm at home or doing personal training, and that's all I do now. I enjoy that a ton. I don't know, I just like figuring things out. I've always loved doing that. How to make things work better, either, you know, whether it's to get leaner or build more strength, or for them just to feel better and look better. We always try and figure things out, and I love doing that. I'm up late at night because I can't sleep. I'm so used to the baseball thing still.
Yeah.
That still gets me is...
That's one thing I was going to ask you.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you, and just interject real quick. So my question is, it's common that athletes have inner demons that haunt them about the game. There's something similar to PTSD. Do you have any symptoms or any type of demons that haunt you that kind of keep you up at night? Just the stress of the game on the mound and so forth?
You know, no demons, but I still have that. It's like when evening comes around, it's like I start getting fired up. As tired as I can be, sometimes, as exhausted as I can be some days, it's right around 8, 9 o'clock, it's like I start waking up again, and it's like game time for me, you know? And I don't probably get to bed sometimes till 2 or 3 in the morning, and I can go to bed at, you know, 10, be in bed, and still not sleep.
Yeah.
And I think part of that's just from so used to being up in during the game, and then you have all that adrenaline going, but you got nowhere to put it and nowhere to let it go.
Right.
So now you're just stuck there, just like, okay, you can only watch so much TV, you can only do so much research on workouts and things like that, and you're just like, it gets crazy sometimes.
Yeah, I bet.
But, and then every now and then, those like you said, those things kind of creep in where, man, if I'd have just thrown a different pitch, you know?
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll watch video every now and then, and I can name certain pitches. I'll remember that at bat, that outing to that certain player. I was like, and just before it's coming up, I'm like, God, why did you throw that? You know, you're so set up for something else, and you throw that, and you're just like, don't throw it, crack. And you're just like, God, you still shake my head at some things.
Wow. That's a good question also when it comes to baseball. And a lot of people probably don't know, maybe people that aren't really baseball players or baseball fans, how much of a decision or input does a pitcher have on what they pitch? Or does it come from the bullpen? Or does it come from the locker room, not the locker room, but from where the dugout is? Do you have choice, full range, or do you have to do what they want you to do?
As you get older, it's ultimately your decision, and I think it just depends too on how much success you're having as a pitcher. Otherwise, when you're a rookie, pitching coach is going to kind of guide you through the game as the catcher would also. They're just kind of getting used to the stuff you have and consistency that you have with your pitches, and they'll go according to that. You may want to throw, you know, you may be one of these young kids that throws 100, you know, 98 to 100 and dazzling everybody with a great fastball, but if you can't control it, and another pitch is working better, obviously you're not going to throw your fastball. No matter how many times you shake it off, you shake off the curveball, they're going to come out and talk to you and say, hey, listen, your fastball is good, but you can't control it. We got to go with this right now, at this point in time. And that's just the motivation I think you need as a young person playing to get better. You know, you can't just sit there and just throw like a long time ago. Now it's there's a lot more that goes into the game. Some of the information they have now is immense. I mean, they have tons and tons of information, night games, day games, grass, turf, when the stadium's closed, when it's open, innings, pitches, all kinds of stuff. It gets crazy, the information they have now with the sabermetrics and everything. But yeah, I mean, like I said, as you get older, you have more free range as to what pitches you want to throw and everything like that.
They give you more range.
Yeah.
Yeah,
cool. Yeah.
Well, you have the experience. They say, hey, I can't teach him anything. He's been in the damn league for 20 years. So if there's one thing you could do different, out of your own, and you can answer this question broadly, it doesn't have to pertain to baseball. If there's anything you could do different, what would it be?
Well, I think, as a player, I mean, you always think you could have done things so much more better. You could have trained better. You could have done more. Could have done your homework, more homework. You know, and as far as scouting, you're reading the reports and this and that. You know, and you do, but I mean, it gets exhausting. It really does. After a while, you get like, you know, this is it. I'm done. I can't read anymore. And then as the game unfolds, you know, you pay attention and everything, and so you always, I don't know, I guess you always second guess yourself as to what you could have done to make yourself better. And then that, like right now, I'm thinking, well, I could have trained harder.
Yeah.
I could have worked more on you know, my, you know, pitching inside or pitching away, or I could have worked more on spotting, you know, fastballs and things like that. But to be honest, sometimes you can't, because at the time you're doing it, that's, you're doing everything 100% to the best of your ability and all that, and, you know, you don't leave anything left to chance. But I think, you know, like I said, you always think in your mind, like, I could have done something better. But I actually tried that one time real quick in 1999 or 98. Mm-hmm. I was throwing a bullpen, and my pitching coach, Leo Mazzoni, one of the greatest pitching coaches ever. Mm-hmm. He's in the bullpen watching me, and I threw a curveball. It's pretty good. Threw another one, and I kind of said, damn it, under my breath, you know. And he goes, what's wrong with that? I go, ah. He goes, and he stood up, he goes, you think you could have thrown one better? I go, yeah. And he says, bullshit, let me see. I throw one, of course it was, and I bounce it about 20 feet in front of the plate and goes over the backstop, and he goes, there you go, see? Stay within yourself. What was wrong with the first two curveballs? They were great. Get people out with that. And that was all that matters. You get people out, and that's it. But sometimes I think you're too hard on yourself, or you think you can do something better, and you really can't. And, you know, it just goes back to maybe you could have done better, but at the same time, at that point in time, if you're really, really dedicated, you've done it. And you've done your homework. It's, now it's just time to go out and play and execute your game plan.
Yeah.
And pitch.
I think when pitchers probably, they're not satisfied until the ball bursts in the flames, right?
Yeah.
That's for sure. Well, you had a 96 mile an hour first fastball, wasn't it? 90 something?
Yeah. That's probably average fast. Like 95, 96. 94 to 96 miles an hour most of my career. And then there was a point in time where I was able to throw triple digits.
Really?
Yeah, the fastest pitch I ever threw was 102.
That's fast.
And it didn't feel, though, everything was so in sync and so smooth. Everything just worked perfectly. So the effort, it didn't feel like there was any effort into it, and the ball just, it was like it was just jumping out of my hand. And it just got there, you know? It's just boom. It's a great feeling. And then, you know, you try and repeat that.
Yeah.
Of course, you screw it up. Mm-hmm. You know, try and make things better.
Well, that's just
trying too hard.
Well, Rudy, here I have just three of your baseball cards. And you actually played so long, there's a stack like that thick of all your cards. How many teams was it different? About nine teams, right?
Nine different major league teams and 13 different organizations.
That's awesome, man. Now, the controversy, like when Jose Canseco came out back in the days, and I don't want to dip too much into this because I know it's a very delicate subject, especially being still heavily involved and having a lot of friends and people that still are probably involved in it. But when Jose Canseco came out, and was kind of just blurted everything out about the steroid situation, substance abuse, steroids, you know, how did it affect you as far as in the game? And just maybe was there a big cloud over baseball for a while, and it kind of, did it make it a very, it's a very unique situation? Or
yeah, situation? Yeah, when he came out with all that stuff, yeah, there was a huge cloud over baseball, and people were, you know, anytime you do something great, you know, especially the hitters, anytime hitters got hit a home run or something like that, you always heard a little chant, you know, take more steroids, do this, do that, whatever, and all that. And that got old quick, you know. But for pitchers, there wasn't really a whole lot going on with that. But, you know, I can imagine for the, when we'd see, you're just like, all right, enough with the steroid stuff, you know.
Yeah.
And sometimes it'd be like a little second baseman, you know, just happen to find one and hit it out.
On steroids.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. You know, now the bat boy's on him too. You know, that kind of thing. But wow.
So you gotta be able to see that. But
I was never good hitting. I'm never good hitting. Man, one of the scariest at bats I ever had was against a guy named Matt Manti, who was with Florida at the time. And this guy, you know, he's throwing gas, you know, high 90s. On a good day, he'll put up triple digits. And I was supposed to bunt off this guy. Mm-hmm. And his first pitch is 97 high and tight. And I was like, I looked at the catcher. I go, are you kidding me with that? I go, just fastball away, man.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's scary.
Needless to say, I didn't make any contact, struck out. But it was scary to see how fast the ball gets on you.
What was it like pitching or batting? How was your batting?
My batting was horrible.
Really?
I've had five at bats and five strikeouts. Although I did walk one
the
time.
The whole time?
Yeah. Yeah, you didn't get too many at bats as a reliever.
Oh, well, you know.
But the one time I did get on base, it was a walk. And it was in Arizona. And I was just like, all right, this is pretty neat. Pretty nervous too, because that was the first time I'd ever been on base. So I look over in the dugout and guys are kind of laughing because I don't know what the hell to do. All I'm going to do is just haul ass. You know, if ball gets hit, I'm hauling ass and getting out of the way just in case there's a double play. And as luck would have it, man, the next guy up, home run. So I'm like, oh my God, this is crazy. So I get to trot around the bases and actually scored a run. So I scored one run in my career.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore. Bells will ring, ting-a-ling-a-ling, ting-a-ling-a-ling, and you'll sing Vita Bella. Hearts will play tippy-tippy-tay, tippy-tippy-tay, like a guitarandella. When the stars make you drool, just like a pastifazzo.